Now we need to know about the normal distribution, which is a very important aspect for as far as the Six Sigma is concerned. So if you really see what is the normal distribution, say for example, assume that in a class of in an auditorium there are about 100 adult Indian males have assembled, 100 adult Indian males have assembled, and then we want to predict what is going to be the range in height of all these 100 people. Is it possible for us to predict? Yes, it is possible, because you find that an average adult Indian, the height will be between say 5 feet to 6 feet, or if you calculate in terms of centimeters, it may be minimum may be 150 and maximum may be say 185. Okay, centimeters, if you calculate in centimeters. So how do you arrive at this fact, this 150 and 185? It is based on, because you know that over the last for so many years we have collected the data and we found that there is a pattern. So we find that there is a pattern in the height of the Indian adult males, and then whenever we take some random samples and then we try to find out, we find that the range will always be within this. So this is because the height of the Indian males are normally distributed. So what is meant by normally distributed? So that's what you are going to see now. So I think most of you would have seen in the curve like this. So this is actually whenever your population is normally distributed, we just represent it in form. We call this as a bell curve or a normal distribution curve. And then we see that here we sign that most of this, the peak is somewhere in the middle, we call that as a mean, and then the distribution is like coming down on both the sides. So if you see the characteristics of normal distribution, it will look like a we call that as a bell curve. And then we find that the tails are asymptotic. So what do you mean by asymptotic? That means it is not touching the x-axis, it is just running parallel to the x-axis. So that means both the tails will not touch the x-axis at all, it will meet only at the infinity. That's why we call that as asymptotic. And then curves can be divided into equal half with pieces falling either side. So you can say that it is equally distributed both on the left and right side. And the most frequently occurring value, that is the mean, is at the center. Then the area under the curve, total area under the curve is 1. And a normal curve indicates a random or chance variation. So that means if you are collecting the data and we are saying that it is normally distributed, so that means the process is running only because of the chance variations or the common cause variations. The common cause variations can also be called as a chance variation or a random variation. So that means the process is running only under the influence of common cause variation, and there are no special cause variations in that. Okay, so we will learn more about it in the analysis phase. Okay, so the peak of the curve represents the center of the process. Then normal distributions are divided into 3 standard deviations on each side of the mean. So suppose we represent mean as mu and standard deviation at sigma, then we find that on both the sides we have, this is minus sigma, minus 2 sigma and minus 3 sigma. Same way this is plus sigma, plus 2 sigma and 3 sigma. So that means the entire curve can be accommodated within plus minus 3 sigma. So this is actually a property of, this is a property of normal distribution. Okay. So now we find that the normal distribution is characterized by mean and standard deviation. So whenever we have a population and whenever we know what is the mean and what is the standard deviation, then we will be able to immediately tell about the process. So a normal distribution is characterized by the mean, this is the mean and this is the standard deviation. So this plus minus 3 sigma will be accommodating the 100% of the values. Okay, so here many times we find that, say for example, now your company is manufacturing pens, then the diameter of the pens, the specification of the pen is that it should meet 10 plus minus 0.5 millimeters. So in this case, the LSL, that is the lower specification limit, LSL is 9.5 and USL is the upper specification limit, that is equal to 10.5. So this is what is the lower upper specification limit and lower specification limit. So now we have seen that 100% of the data point, and then assume that for this production process the mean is equal to 10 and sigma is equal to 0.1. So that means 100% of the data points will lie between 10 plus minus 3 into sigma, that is equal to 10 plus minus 0.3. That is between 9.7 to 10.3. So that means this point will be 9.7 and this will be 10.3. So that means this process or the machine which is producing these pens will always be able to meet the requirements of the customer, because the machine will always produce the pens with outer diameter between 9.7 to 10.3, whereas the customer is willing to accept from 9.5 to 10.5. But suppose if there is a problem in the machine and then the variation in the variation has increased and sigma has become 0.2, then in the revised case what will happen? Mu is equal to 10 and sigma is equal to 0.2. In that case, then the distribution will be somewhere like this. So now what happens? The specification limit remains the same because the customer has not revised the specification. But your the output will become 10 plus minus 3 into 0.2. That is equal to 10 plus minus 0.6. That is 9.4 to 10.6. So that means this becomes 10.6 and this becomes 9.4. So whereas the customer is going to accept only up to 10.5. So that means whatever you are going to produce less than 9.5, and whatever you are going to produce more than 10.5, these are going to be rejections. Okay. So this again we will learn more about it whenever you are calculating the process capability. So this is actually very important to know at this point of time, because whenever you are going to calculate the process capability, then you will find whatever the learnings you have got today is going to be very useful to you. So you have to understand is that whenever you know the mean and the standard deviation, then we will be able to predict what will be the total spread of the entire population. That means the 100% of the data will be lying between the mu plus minus 3 sigma. So that is the learning you will have to have at this point of time. And then another important aspect here is, as I told you, almost 100%, that is not 100%, it is exactly 99.73% of the data points will be lying between. So if you see, this is a mu, we have considered as 0. Then we have considered sigma is equal to 1 here. So that is the reason. So this is actually 3 sigma and this is minus 3 sigma. So we find that almost 99.73% of the lies between plus minus 3 sigma. 95% of the data points lie between plus minus 2 sigma. And 68% of the data points lie between plus minus sigma. So this is a very important concept that you need to understand. So that means whenever a population is distributed, 68% of the data point will be lying between plus minus sigma. 95% of the data points will be lying between plus minus 2 sigma. And 99.73% will be lying between plus minus 3 sigma. Okay.